here at least once a year. So there are many things which bring me from time to time to not only to London but also to Dublin, as I follow financial regulation. There are many issues which are also of interest to Dublin as a financial center, which is strong certainly in fund management, which I follow, for example, but also as a center which has got also huge problems in its banking sector, strong support by the state for its banking sector, on which I also wrote a report about 2 years ago on state aid and banking, a very topical issue for Ireland, which we were still discussing this morning, and I think which I will discuss this afternoon, let's say, also with somebody else in the Ministry of Finance. Anyhow, let's say really it's a pleasure, because you may think, let's say, you're a small institute, but I think structure-wise, CEPS and IIEA are very similar, let's say, in the kind of activities which we do, the way we are organized. We may be different, I mean, in size, but of course, yeah, we are located in Brussels, and you know, let's say that Brussels is a center of decision-making, and I think our budget has grown from about 2 million to 9 million this year, from about 2 million in 2000 to about 9 million now, because there's so much going on in Brussels, and we have to be on top of so many different issues. And one of the things which we do with the multinational team in Brussels at CEPS is trying to follow or trying to participate in tenders for studies for the EU, and that's one of our kind of, has become one of our niche markets. If you see, let's say you go to the official journal, you see how many studies the commission commissions on many different things, which is a public and open market. And we have become very kind of very successful in that. Let's say that's one of the reasons for our growth as an institute. But separately from that, we also have, like IIEA, we have sponsors who support us. We have task forces, as you do, working parties on many different issues. I would like to have been in the one this morning on the UK and Europe, or the UK. It was the UK and Europe, or the UK and Ireland, the one this morning. That's also an issue of debate in Brussels. So. Oh, that's the conclusions. I have to go to the start. On this paper which I wrote, which is in fact about a year old, I wrote it, I myself am Belgian. Speaking about federalism in Belgium is nothing new. I mean, Belgium has been debating a more federal model since about 40 years, has advanced to some degree in that direction. The reason why it took us such a long time to have a government last year, after about 500 days, was also related to this F word. I mean, in the sense that the disagreements on both sides, let's say, about what we call the Brussels and the definition of Brussels and how you restrict Brussels, which to some extent had to do, let's say, with the respect of change in some of the federal kind of the consensus which was there between the two groups, essentially two groups in Belgium. But anyhow, if you go a bit further in other member states in the EU, you will see that federalism is not such a common word. And basically, if you go walk around or you travel around in the EU. I presented this paper, for example, in the Netherlands in February this year, and I felt immediately, to my great surprise, that federalism is a no word in the Netherlands. I don't speak about France, or I don't speak about the UK. No, it was, they said very clearly to me, even after my presentation, no, the EU is not a federal construction. There you are. I think, let's say, that's how I discovered, let's say, that basically it's a taboo. I mean, the word federal, you cannot use it. We're just discussing over lunch where has the EU used the word, and it's indeed, as you mentioned, let's say, in the State of the Union of Barroso in the month of September, he used a federation of states. He didn't use federalism as a word. He used a federation of states. And I think, let's say, there was even some discussion about the French versus the German translation of his speech, how that word was translated. In fact, let's say the EU defined itself in a word which I've known all the time, but which I've never basically understood, as the méthode communautaire. That's how they call it in Brussels, as part of the old French tradition, which was very strong in Brussels until about 20 years ago. The EU was all about the méthode communautaire. I mean, define it as you can. But also, let's say, it has to do with the origins of the EU. The EU, and that is often also forgotten, let's say, if we speak about the EU today, the EU is a top-down model, was created after the war, let's say, just to make sure that there was no more war. It was the heads of state and government, which is also one of these new abbreviations. I do not know whether you know that one, HOSG, which has come up above all in the crisis. It's the heads of state and government which decide things. I mean, if you look at our kind of constitution as we have it for the moment, it's basically signed by some kings, some presidents, in other countries that may be head of state, or maybe the president of a federal republic, or maybe a king. In the United States, basically, the first sentence of the Constitution is, we the people. So basically what we have to do is in the current context, we want to become a more federal union, but we have to turn the pyramid around. Let's say from this top-down method, let's say from the creation by a series of forward-looking heads of state and government, who said we never want wars in the EU anymore, we'll have to become a union now which is supported by the people. A bottom-up approach, where it's really becoming, a federal model, let's say, but everything is done and at level where it should be doing, where it should be happening, and if it cannot be done at the lower level, it goes up. And that's the way it should be in a kind of in a clear and a well-functioning federal model. But my big question remains, can we reverse this kind of this approach, let's say, or can we turn around this pyramid? If we have been created always as an EU, I mean, top-down, can we make it bottom-up? If you look around in Brussels and if you, for example, at the functioning of the Commission, still the core of the EU institutions, the Commission until today is still very much a top-down institution in the way it applies policies. The Commission thinks it would be useful to liberalize this sector or to regulate that sector, and it makes proposals without, in fact, no, it has to consult, but without basically acting on, for example, what the Parliament would ask. No, it's because the Commission, with some very strong forward-looking civil servants is thinking we should regulate in this area, and they start to regulate. And this goes on until today. I mean, you look, may look an area which I follow closely, this Liikanen report, which was published 2 or 3 weeks ago, a report written by Commission officials. Now they think, as a result of the financial crisis, that banks have to be split up in one side investment banks and the other side commercial banks. I mean, it's basically a proposal by the Commission. Of course, there has been some pressure from some groups in the parliament to do something on that. But it's basically, if it's not coming out, it's the Commission who's asked Liikanen and who's staffed the group to make these proposals, which they, on which they may now be legislating in the coming weeks and months. So the question remains, let's say, to what is the federal model which we have today and how do we give it content in this crisis? I mean, if we speak about this, of course, what will come up certainly in my talk, let's say, is then federal for who? Federal for the 27, for 30, or for only for a smaller group? I mean, the issue of concentric circles. And that, that is part of this. But this is just as a way to remind you that the EU is composed already today of many different circles. And probably an important one to remind you, Schengen, on which Ireland is not a member. But in Schengen, you also have Switzerland. So Switzerland is a non-EU member state, is involved in many forms of cooperation with the EU, has many bilateral deals with the EU, and a very important one where they're fully part of it is Schengen, where the UK and Ireland are not part of it. Of course, you have the Eurozone, which you all know very well. Let's say then we very soon have a new member, Croatia, which most people are not aware of. Let's say that the EU is still expanding. We're also negotiating with 5 other member states for the moment. Serbia was the latest, which was, I think, agreed upon only a few months ago. I think it was in the June European Council that they started negotiations with Serbia. So the EU is still expanding while we're trying to deepening the construction which we have at the moment. If you look at, let's say, what has happened through the financial crisis, and that was, in fact, one of the reasons why I wrote this paper, is that you see kind of some duality in approach. To some extent, let's say, we are strengthening, we are more and more deepening, improving our structure. But on the other hand, sometimes it is unclear, let's say, whether it's really sufficiently strengthening the decision-making, making a more federal economic union, yes or no. But I've summed it up here, and if you look over a 2.5-year period of sovereign crisis for Greece started somewhere in March 2010, so it's about 2.5 years ago. But it's 5-year financial crisis. Northern Rock was 2007, so that's already quite a time. But if you now look at this in one slide, you effectively see that a lot has been done over a 2.5-year period in the direction of probably a more federal economic model. One important thing is that we have, in fact, basically now just implemented, it was agreed in March, but we have basically just now implemented this new stability mechanism. It was formally, I think last week at the European Council in Brussels, formally inaugurated, the ESM. So we now have something like an IMF for Europe. And that's, I think, a big step forward. That was a change to the treaty, which, remember, also because I'm speaking in Ireland, before the crisis, changes to the treaty were almost impossible simply to imagine politically. We also have, let's say, the growth and stability pact changes. One element of that is still hanging, which is what they call the duopoly, which is still before the parliament. And if you look at the council conclusions from last week, they urge the parliament to adopt the duopoly. But in the six-pack, there are some very important measures that we learn the lessons from the crisis, and we say we have to look at a broader set of economic variables than only those which were defined in the Maastricht Treaty. Maastricht Treaty was basically the 3 and the 60%. No, they broadened this to, for example, also looking at the current account, let's say at the sustainability of the public finances and so on. But one important element in there is that the Commission can directly impose fines. And this can only be undone with a reverse majority. So if there is no group voting in the Council against what the Commission proposes, say, if, for example, a member state doesn't respect what it has agreed with the Commission in the context of the Growth and Stability Act, the Commission can directly impose fines without waiting for the Council. Of course, the procedure is it first has to propose something to the Council, a recommendation to the Council. The Council doesn't react. The Commission can, in the next step, directly impose fines. In the past, before the crisis, it had all to go through the Council. No, it's the Commission, which is in the center. And that's why, in fact, basically before the crisis, why was it that we didn't use the means which were there? It was always pushed up to the Council, handled diplomatically, and basically nothing happened. You may remember that in the case of Greece, for example, already in 2009, there were very clear warnings against Greece, but Greece didn't act. Greece didn't do anything because you had diplomatically getting from the Council, but the Council didn't have any teeth. Now the Commission formally has teeth, but we'll have to see, it's too early to say, whether it will really use this. On the financial supervisory side, of course, I follow this very closely, as I said already. I will speak about this in a moment. I mean, there's, for me, the most important progress on that side is the banking union dossier. We'll come back to that in a moment, but basically we're moving towards a federal supervisory authority, like you have in the United States with the Fed, Federal Reserve, or like you have in Canada, both federal constructions with the Bank of Canada. I mean, but so far, let's say we are not entirely consistent in that, and that's, again, let's say why this is important. So far, for deposit insurance and liquidation of banks, that remains national. I mean, there have been contradictory positions on that recently, but if you look at the last European Council conclusions, the one from last week, basically that issue, where, as they said in June, we'll need to have this Europeanized as well, all of a sudden it has dropped from the agenda, and they simply say we need to have the Commission proposals in this field adopted, nothing more. I mean, for the moment, they don't speak yet about truly European-wide deposit insurance and liquidation procedures for banks. And then we also have some governance changes. Probably the most important one is that, or the two last important ones, let's say, are the most important ones, that more powers for Olli Rehn and the Commission, the Vice President in charge of Economic Affairs. That was, for example, repeated last week again by Schauble in his speech. That was already to some extent agreed. But also, let's say that there would be a separate Eurozone president. I don't know where this dossier is formally, but this was agreed, I think, about a year ago, that there would be a separate president for the Eurozone Council, separately from the Eurogroup, that there would be, apart from Van Rompuy for the European Council, there would be a Van Rompuy bis for the Eurozone Council. But I do not know exactly where this dossier is for the moment. This is just to put it somewhat into perspective. I mean, if we speak about this crisis, we often forget, let's say, that Eurozone overall, let's say, is not doing too badly economically. I mean, we speak all the time about the figures of the member states of the Eurozone, let's say, now all the problems which there are. But basically, I mean, Eurozone is doing better or much better on many regards than the United States. And a figure, for example, which is not on here, which I could also mention, is that if you look at Eurozone and Eurozone's export potential, of course, you see that our current account is more or less in balance. But the Eurozone has been expanding its exports, an important issue also for Ireland, over the last 10 years, where, for example, the United States or Japan has been declining. So we have been capable in a multipolar world to become more competitive. And you look at the economic figures which we have, I mean, they are not as bad, but we tend to forget this. For example, if you look at public debt, budget deficit, inflation. The worst things are, of course, economic growth, which is discussion at the moment. Let's say that there is too much austerity and too little economic growth. So, I mean, that depends on the forecast which you follow. The Commission says it may be still status quo for the moment, so 0%. Some other forecasts are at minus 0.5%. But also unemployment, a big problem, as we all know, certainly in southern European countries. And it has been rising. In the beginning of the crisis, we were lower than the US. US has been declining and EU has been increasing, or the Eurozone has been increasing. Also, let's say, as a result of, let's say, in fact, what is ongoing is there have been radical adjustments in labor costs. So we are adjusting, European countries are adjusting, meaning also that we have to reckon that in a few years from now, let's say, some new kind of heavens of competitiveness could emerge in the south of Europe. Who knows? Let's say we shouldn't be all be doom thinking. So the in certain countries, like also in Ireland, I mean, I think that's the steepest increase, but also the steepest decline. But also Greece, Portugal, to a lesser extent Spain, you see that there is an impact, let's say, of what is being discussed already at the moment. Let's say the fact that they have to adjust their public finances and bring their households in order. You see it very clearly on the map. In fact, these are data from the European Commission. So, but if you look at the solution which have been proposed to deal with the crisis, what I fear the most, let's say, is that so far we have, in fact, a bit hesitated between more federal approaches, in fact, giving EU institutions, the Commission, the ECB, others more powers, and more intergovernmental solutions. And my central thesis is that as long as we are unclear enough about this, that will not be good for Europe. And let's say we're not kind of really managing to emerge from this crisis, or there will always be problems to really take decisions at European level if we need to take decisions. On the one hand, let's say I mentioned already some of these things in the more central role for the Commission in the economic governance measures. I'll speak about the role of the ECB in a moment, because I think it's the most federal economic policy institution which we have. But you also see it in the area of supervision with the emergence of a European-wide banking supervisor that is clearly federal. Also, more technically, if you look at the financing cost, also important for this country through the EFSF and the ESM, is basically using the low, refinancing cost of the best countries of the Eurozone, and to use that average, let's say, to reduce the financial burden for countries in problem, like also for Portugal or for Greece. On the other hand, if you look, let's say, at the way in which the EFSF or the ESM today is functioning, it's clearly intergovernmental, meaning the most, not all, but most decisions in the EFSF, if you have to support a country, have to be decided by unanimity. If there is no lot of decision about, for example, the aid to Spain and the aid to the Spanish banks, some people are concerned, let's say, that the banks in Spain will be bailed out at 100%. I don't think so. I mean, there was a lot of discussion, I think, again over the weekend and after last week's European Council, that all of a sudden people now realize that Spanish banks wouldn't get 100% a blanco check. I think, let's say, that was for my part already clear in the month of June, because it was very clearly said that it will be the ESM which will decide applying EU competition policy rules. And applying EU competition policy rules, which I should have probably added as one of the federal elements of our economic governance model, which means, let's say, that first a viable plan for these banks has to be presented to the Commission, and on that basis, some capital injection can be agreed upon. But also, let's say, that will be even more the case in the ESM. So far, most banks have been aided, be helped by their local authorities. If no, Spain, since it's insufficient cash, is calling upon the ESM, the decision basically is taken by the board of the ESM and has to be taken by unanimity. So I think it will be even more applicable to Spain that it will have to put its banks in order first before it will get money because of this unanimous decision of the ESM. Certainly, if you ask the Netherlands, Finland, and Germany to agree with this, one of the brick part of the ESM, that will be very important for Spain. But then some other aspects, let's say, also you may have forgotten about some of these other elements which I mentioned of the crisis, like the Euro Plus Pact was something which was agreed upon about 2 years ago about, let's say, how we can strengthen the competitiveness of the Eurozone. It was basically Germany imposing its views on the rest of the Eurozone, let's say, on how they should be competitive. Fiscal Compact, in the meantime, is something intergovernmental as well. Let's say it's a separate intergovernmental treaty how to improve stability and economic governance in the Eurozone. It's already been forgotten in the meantime. It's not that new, but, the thing is about this, it was an intergovernmental treaty. Also, if you look at, for example, some documents from Van Rompuy and others about defining the words competitiveness, and what should be done to improve that, you see there is a certain view on that. It should be all kind of a strong manufacturing industry which exports. You need to have current account surpluses. You need to have export surpluses. But if we were to be a Eurozone of 17 or an EU of 27 all exporters, I mean, we couldn't survive. I mean, the rest of the world should be buying of our goods. But also, let's say, I mean, the issue I think where we have failed most, let's say, in this crisis, who speaks for the Eurozone? We certainly don't have one person who speaks for that. Of course, we have it for the monetary policy side, but not for the economic policy side. And that's, I think, what has cost us dear, certainly, over the last 2 years, because many people speak and many people, certainly ministers of finance or heads of state, and have different messages. I think, as I said, let's say the ECB is probably the most federal institution today. And we know, let's say, certainly if you read the German media, there are quite some disagreements about its role. But it's basically because there is no other institution doing the task. I mean, the ECB has been asked now in this recent new action, which will start, let's say, in the outright monetary transactions, the OMT at the bottom, basically has become a fiscal agent. And that's what, if you follow German media, German academics, we're saying the ECB cannot do this because that is a fiscal action. So this is not a monetary policy action, this is a fiscal action. Why? Because the ECB will support it if these states are under a program. Basically, which is linking a monetary policy decision with a fiscal policy one. And that's why, I mean, many very well-known academics also in Germany, argue, let's say, that the ECB, what it's doing, is illegal. And if you read German media, you will read every day, day after day, let's say, many articles about this. And you would often think, let's say, that the whole thing will be falling apart. I don't know. We had a discussion over this, about this over lunch, how to interpret this debate in Germany. It's probably more, let's say, a kind of a backward fight, let's say, to try to get back some powers for the Bundesbank. But I don't know, essentially. I don't think, let's say, personally, there is a problem, let's say, because the ECB, as I said, let's say, no other strong fiscal authority in the Eurozone. And also, as the ECB can act very rapidly, basically, the ECB can act in a matter of a few weeks or a few days if it's needed. It can act, also decide very rapidly. It can act very rapidly as a federal institution. And we also have to remember, let's say, that since the announcement of the banking union at the end of June, and also since the ECB announced this at the end of July, that basically we have got an enormous decline in the refinancing rates for Italy and above all for Spain, and much more calmer financial markets than we used to have over many summers during this financial crisis. Fiscal compact, I shouldn't say too much about this, let's say, but anyway, was about a year ago an important issue, has a bit disappeared from the agenda. We still have to remember that two states did not sign it, so it's an intergovernmental treaty between intended to be 27 member states, but the UK was very famous. I mean, Cameron walked out of that meeting and said he will not sign it, but also the Czechs have not signed it, we have to remember. But a very strange thing about this is that it will enter into force after 1 year, so it should be somewhere March or so next year, if a majority of member states have signed it. So it's applicable as an intergovernmental treaty if a majority of member states have signed it. So in this sense, it is somewhat federal, even if it's an intergovernmental treaty. I think the biggest example now, and that's where my expertise on financial regulation is extremely useful for the degree to which we're becoming a more federal model, is this banking union proposal, which has for many people came off the blue. The commission is saying, let's say, that they originated it, but many people in Brussels or in the EU are still arguing about where is the word coming from. But it was then all of a sudden proposed in the European Council at the end of June that the ECB should become the federal supervisory authority for the Eurozone, following an article in the treaty, Article 127.6, which basically says if there's unanimity vote in the Finance Council, the ECB can become the federal banking supervisor. And I've written several commentaries on this. I'm fairly in favor about this. I think that's a very good development, because what we have seen in the Eurozone is that there was far too much, as we call it in Dutch, within national constructions, the national supervisors knew the local banks, and they knew each other far too well. In the meantime, they didn't want to see the problems in which the banks, how bad the balance sheets of the banks were. I think we've seen this in this country as well, but I've seen this in my own country, in Belgium. We've seen this in the Netherlands. We've seen this in almost all EU countries. And that's why I think, let's say, the move towards a more distant supervisor with multinational supervisors sitting on a team of what they call a college of supervisors to supervise banks will become, for all of us, for taxpayers certainly, much better, I mean, much more of a guarantee for the future than the system which we have today. And it's basically following the system like you had in other federal constructions as we have it today. It also, let's say, will eliminate a kind of an fairly important, dangerous gray area which we have today, which is what we call the emergency liquidity assistance, which can still be done until today. So national central banks can, from their own means, provide support to the national banking sector. In fact, even without formal authorization of the ECB. There is an informal authorization, but it's not seen as a monetary policy action. So it's done, like also happened in Belgium in the case of Fortis. The Belgian central bank gave 50 billion to Fortis in the midst of the crisis from the means of the Belgian central bank, which are in fact the seigneurage benefits which were redistributed to national central banks, which that central bank, Belgian central bank, used to support its own banking sector. If we now move a banking union to the ECB, basically it's saying that financial stability becomes a task for the ECB and is no longer a task for the national central bank, what it is until today. If you read the treaty very carefully, financial stability is a task of the national central bank. So you can ask yourself, the ECB and the treaty says, it says ECB can contribute to financial stability, but the task for financial stability is formally with the national central banks or with the national authorities. I think, let's say, by moving banking supervision to the ECB, we're kind of clarifying, let's say, that that field. And we're moving to a three-peaks model, which I think is also for Ireland important. Let's say we're basically saying only prudential supervision, only what can better be done at European level, so following subsidiarity debate, will be moved up, let's say, to the Eurozone level. But the other things, where there is no kind of overriding argument to move it to the European level, like conduct of business control, product regulation, take, for example, control of investment funds in Ireland, will remain at the local level. I don't see any reason that it will change, and also see no kind of, I don't think, let's say, that will change in the future. So on that level, we continue to have harmonized regulation at European level, but the supervision will remain locally. It's only for banking supervision where they say, look, I mean, if a bank fails in one member state, it has an impact in other member states, as we've seen it certainly in the case also of Spain, with even smaller banks. There, let's say, the argument is very strong, let's say, to have it controlled at the ECB level. For other forms of supervision, which have to do with the way banks behave, or the way, for example, directors work in the board of directors of banks, let's say, that will remain a local competence. But if we see, let's say, already now, let's say, I don't know whether some of you have followed the debate a bit in the media about this banking union, you see already today how complex this discussion is becoming. For example, you have some countries from the outs which are saying we would like to be part of the banking supervision by the ECB, like Hungary, Sweden, Poland, but we want to have something to say, which then means, let's say, you have to adapt the voting modalities within the ECB, but the voting is made for the monetary policy, not for the financial supervision. And they on top say, let's say, these banks within the Eurozone get cheap liquidity from the ECB and the outsiders don't get this. You have the whole debate about the rules, let's say, which rules will apply for which banks. Let's say you have the rules for the 17 and for the 27. You have the whole debate about accountability. How will the ECB be accountable for its supervisory actions, which are different from the monetary policy actions? So that's all ongoing at the moment. The issue had to be resolved for last week's European Council, but is not entirely resolved. For me, the important thing is that they have maintained the target date of the 1st of January 2013 to start it. I mean, it will be a gradual process, but at least to start. But we'll have to see in the coming weeks and months, let's say, whether this will effectively be the case. I think it will be, but I think it will be a gradual process from the 1st of January onwards. Before last slide, let's say, what could a more federal union be? Many people forget, let's say, there are many other areas where the EU could be much more active and where, in fact, where there is limited or no federal competence. In fact, it's sufficient to look at some initiatives which were taken over the last 2 or 3 years. There is, for example, the Monti report on the single market, which outlines some of these areas where, I mean, there could be more federal competences or more federal action. You could also see a growth letter signed by 12 heads, ministers, prime ministers in February 2012, which is also signed by Monti. So he used part of that report, which he did for the Commission in 2010. But if you think about it, I mean, I've only summed up some. Let's say there is much more what could be done at European level. I think the most important ones are, for example, energy supply policy. Energy supply policy today is entirely national. It's not coordinated or very little coordination at European level. So everybody negotiates basically with Russia separately. There's no an important, very important case ongoing of Gazprom being challenged by the EU competition policy authorities for its action in Bulgaria and Romania. That may be, I mean, there may be trends towards more European-wide supply policy, but it's far too limited for the moment. The whole domain of R&D, research and development, is insufficiently, I would say, coordinated at European level. Only 7% of R&D spending today goes through the EU budget. Some people may say that the EU spends a lot on that field. No. Mostly, to a large extent, is still at the national level, and I think insufficiently coordinated. There's also industrial policy overall, let's say, which is insufficiently European. We now see this very clearly in the post-crisis context. Issue for Ireland, very touchy, I know, let's say, harmonization of direct and indirect taxation, which is always coming up, came up in the Euro Plus Pact. Certainly France and Germany are always insisting on that. Certainly direct taxes, corporate taxes, but also indirect taxes. So we have common basis for VAT, but not common rates within the EU. Labour market policies also, we have almost nothing. We have a few things, let's say, but very little. Now, Germany is pushing some of these things, like job qualification, because Germany needs qualified labour. We know it. That's related to the Euro Plus Pact and the fact, let's say, that Germany is pushing a bit its view on competitiveness. But there are many more things. I think about portability of pensions. I mean, if you look at work in an institute like CEPS, if I engage people from abroad, let's say portability of pensions is an issue. If you want to engage somebody only from, for example, the Netherlands, and somebody who's worked there 20 years, it's not easy at all to compete. So I think there's much more which could be added to that list. Just, let's say, to remember, let's say, that the EU is still only a very emerging federal structure for the moment, and that I think, let's say, and that's not a matter of money, it's more a matter of policies, of coordination. I just mentioned the word policy. It's not that the EU should have more money, but if the EU can do better coordination of money and have the competences to do it, I think it could work more efficiently. So to conclude, I think, and that's probably important, sometimes in the past we said, let's say, there's insufficient debate about what the EU is doing. If you look around in the EU, not in all the member states, but in certain member states, and very strongly, like for example in Germany, or in Spain, there is a very deep debate ongoing about what is the raison d'être, the rationale, the aim, the ziel, I mean the German word of the EU. Why do we have the EU? And I think this is leading to this debate about probably we need to have a truly federal model. And I think, let's say, it's the strongest in Germany at the moment, sometimes echoed by Schäuble's comments in the media, like last week again, also by others, like Merkel also, I think, has mentioned this, the word federal in the context of the EU, which EU policymakers do not necessarily do. We have made adaptations on the level of the MU, I mean, but that's too early to see whether they will work. I mean, basically, the means are there to have a more federal economic governance model, at least for the Eurozone. But that's too early to say, let's say, whether it works. We'll have to see this. And of course, we are in a very deep crisis at the moment. The ECB has a central role and will become, like the Fed and the Bank of Canada, this federal supervisor. I think that's also a positive development, but I think a lot remains to be done, and there are a lot of dangers also on the horizon, essentially about the relationship between the ins and outs. Some people have argued, for example, that if we have a stronger, we need a stronger accountability for a parliament in the context of the banking union debate and for economic governance. Basically, the parliament will do this only for the 17. What then about the other 10 countries? Will the parliament only, or will we have a dual EP which will do the accountability for the Eurozone 17 and then not for the rest? These are open questions. So that's part of, say, debate which is ongoing. Do we need to have another treaty change to accommodate for a more federal union? But I think that debate has only started. And as we know, the treaty changes remain, even after this crisis, difficult. That will take another 2 or 3 years before we probably have something clearer on the agenda, what has to be changed at the EU level. Thank you.